All right. Teamer Vanifier, for those not familiar, Prime Speaker Vanifier is a card that's made a bit of a splash in Modern and also seen Fringe play off and on in Standard. So you sacrifice a creature to get another creature that costs exactly one more and put it into play. We call this Fairy Podmother or Podmom because this activation pays homage to the card Birthing Pod. Some sweet tools that we got this season are... Arboreal Grazer as another cheap accelerant, which is awesome. This is also a card that we don't mind sacrificing to find Fibble Thip here. We also have Kiora Behemoth Beckoner, which is a card that can accelerate us into our 5 and 6 drops while also serving as a card to double activate Vanifier in the same turn. And then she also works really well with Rekindling Phoenix. Again, Pentreon, I would encourage you to not think about you have too many basics or you have not enough basics. The correct way to approach mana math is talking about the number of colored sources you have in your magic deck. So in this case, it's not, your argument shouldn't be we have too many basics. The discussion point you should be trying to make is we don't have enough red or blue. So if you think we don't have enough red or blue, say that and we can talk about the math behind it. But it's not just we have too many basics, case closed. Wait, they're adding 16 slots to all of the arena events? Weird. Dunk Daddy, thank you for the 3-month resub. I appreciate that. Welcome back. Thanks for keeping me around. If they're adding a bunch of discretionary slots to the actual Mythic Championships actually makes Savitz being added to the MPL make a lot more sense, because it means these events are going to have more promotional style invites in it, right? So like, he's basically just there as a constant promotional invite, as opposed to... Hey, Marty, thank you for the 37 months. Welcome back. I appreciate you keeping me employed here. I mean, someone said the one drop was late, but it was like right on time to cast Vanifier ahead of time, right? Cry of the Canario. All right, what are my... Hey, Sun Wukong, thank you for the brand new Prime support. I appreciate that. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Thanks for keeping me around. All right, so what four drops do I have here and what do I want to do with them? Did I just like turn Jade Light into Rekindling Phoenix? I think I just turned Jade Light into Rekindling Phoenix, right? I could do this first. Hey, Socratic Phoenix, thanks for the Prime support. I appreciate it. Help myself. So I get to untap this, and then I get to do this. I think I'm gonna keep. Oh, this. It doesn't matter what I'm doing here, right? Because I'm just getting rid of it. Huh? So do I actually want Fibble Thip, or do I want? Fibble Thip lets me draw two cards, although Rekindling Phoenix probably means I get better pressure going, right? Oh, I get to draw off Phoenix. Oh, gosh, that's good. Oh, I don't get to draw. There's a glowing circle of no. In the future, we'll get to draw. In the future, we'll get to draw. Wow, they just missed on a Narset Impulse. That's awesome. Fibble Thip also would have gone poorly, so I'm glad we didn't try to do that. I'll figure it out eventually, I promise. Mastermind's Acquisition, okay. We're kind of going to get to go crazy here, right? I get to, like... Well, I mean, like... We probably knew the MPL was a trash fire when they were supposed to start their exhibition matches in March, and it didn't start till May, right? And then anybody who watched watched the MPL yesterday, saw how much of a dumpster fire it was, right? All right, so I already played a land this turn. I think I want to use my mana, though. I think I'm going to go get Fibblethip and hope he draws me something. Oh, let's go get Squee. Squee sounds awesome against this control deck, right? They just, like, never get rid of this card. So, here's the thing. They didn't hire Jerry in spite of him boycotting Worlds. They hired Jerry because Jerry was hired based on an objective metric, right? So, like, the thing is, like, when they ignore me, I'm not competing in their tournaments, right? So, like, there's probably a good chance that if I, like, qualify for a Mythic Championship, like, just by playing Arena, they're probably not going to tell me I can't play. They're just not going to give me anything special, right? And they technically didn't give Jerry anything special, right? He earned his slot, which is an important distinction there, I think. Wow, this is about... So I get to play Squee, pod Squee into Phoenix, untap Vanifier, pod Phoenix into Scragon Hellkite, kill Narset. That's how this is going to work. And now, unfortunately, I don't get to draw cards from this Kiora because Narset's in play, but I do get to kill the Narset. So, like, it's still, like, pretty much a win. Can you say pod one more time, right? This is the part where Kiora blinks the pod. This is a good... I like when we play a new deck and, like, it gets to do its thing right off the bat. Why is our goblin only cost 3 and is castable? Asking the real questions. Alright, extra Phoenix sounds good, couple of Vivian sounds good, couple of Tameos sound good. They probably don't have artifacts and enchantments I care about, they don't have creatures I care about bouncing. Why are so many people playing Augur of Bolas? Because Scotty doesn't know. You know, I wonder, so like, Hydroid Crisis felt like a really necessary inclusion in this deck last season. I wonder if there's enough Narsets in these grindy decks that I just don't want to play this card anymore. Could that be real? I think I'm gonna cut these greasers. Negate is probably fine here. How many lands are we playing? We're on 25 lands. Yeah, we're on 25 lands. Sun's Avatar. Does that cost 5 or 6? Cost 6. 6 is a lot. Ravager Worm is probably just better than Sun's Avatar at 6. It just, like, eats things and has haste. Ravager, we hardly knew her. Perfect. Never didn't have it, etc., etc. Real decks have curves, chat. And then there's this forest. This non-foil forest. It shall be our greatest shame. 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 Alright, my hand's great. Pick your favorite. Oh, I wasn't. I'm just so surprised they took Fibblethip. I just assumed I was casting Fibblethip there. That's why I didn't play the Stomping. I was checking a Discord message, and I was like, oh, I'm just gonna cast Fibblethip this turn, right? Apologies. Didn't matter because they had more discard spells, but that's why I didn't play the Stomping Ground there. We have a 4-mana Bolas. We're bedeviling my Land War Elves. All right, I mean, if we hit Red Source into other land, our hand is kind of absurd, right? That being said, if they have Nikki B here, we're probably dead. Naked Eldest Reborn, sure. This is, it's really unfortunate that, like, the worst part about having 25 lands in my deck is I can't include this game in my autobiography 26 lands later. So people that were asking how Grixis wins games earlier, this is how Grixis wins games. I think I'm happy and I'm going to click submit. Let's just draw some lands this time after we get triple discarded. Did I add a command for, was it magic? Welcome. I think it was welcome. I feel like I added a command for it. The bot seems to be dying at the moment, though. This hand is absurd. 1, 2, 3. It's just elementary. What could it be? Didn't get to rest on one now. So it's really important that I play Steam Vents on 2 here, because this way, if I draw Rekindling Phoenix next turn, I'll be able to cast it if they take this away from me. That being said, if they just, like, don't discard spell me here, and if they don't have a counter spell, this Tameo prevents them from playing future discard spells. Yeah, I'm planning to catch up on all the Jerry news after I'm done today. I think I just named Prime Speaker here, right? Let me aid your research. Just like, want to name a 4-of, that's good. And hey, look, that been to Rekindling Phoenix that she can pick back up later. I would like the record to reflect that kids these days who want to tell me that if you're going to be someone that wants to try and tell me that Thought Erasure is Thought Seize adjacent, you don't know what we've suffered through, okay? Thought Erasure costing 2 is incredibly different than Thought Seize. I don't want to hear anything different. I could have had Phoenix. Yeah, but I don't really care about negate, right? Because this says they can't discard spell me. Glowing Circle of No! Glowing Circle of No! Glowing Circle of No! Glowing Circle of No! Alright, what's a card that there's a lot of in my deck that I would want to draw? Hydrate Crisis? I think it's Hydrate Crisis. I think you will find there's 3 of those in my deck still. I mean, to be fair, this card's like not seeing play in fair decks right now. 3, yeah, this deck is just like a Rekindling Phoenix deck at its core, right? How are we doing, folks? Welcome, welcome, welcome. Good morning, good afternoon, good night to everybody wherever you're at in the world. Thanks for hanging out here today. My name is Jeff Hoagland. I'm a full-time streamer and content producer here on Twitch. I'm here playing Magic 30, 40, sometimes even 50 hours a week. If you enjoy Constructed Magic, this is definitely the channel for you. I play a ton of different decks here, and I wouldn't be here day in and day out without my wonderful subs, so I, as always, like to take a second to say thank you to all of them for keeping me employed. I also like to plug a couple of my sponsors here really quick before we move on to the next match. The Nerd Rage Gaming Championship Series, a $5,000 cash tournament series that happens every single month in the Midwestern United States. If you can't make it out to the Midwest to play in one of their standard, modern, or legacy tournaments, be sure to check out their streaming coverage as well at twitch.tv/NRG series. You will also, if you want to see me play some paper magic, I'm going to be playing in their modern tournament in Iowa this weekend, so be sure to tune in to see me play some paper cards. BCW Supplies are the only ones I trust to protect my very valuable paper Magic the Gathering cards, and if you use code Jeff10 at bcwsupplies.com, you can save 10% on sleeves, binders, deck box, and all sorts of other fantastic gaming accessories there with them. Jonesy! Thank you for the 12 months of support. Have a sword to go with your shield. Thanks for keeping me around. PlayDKP.com makes a very unique product, the Dragon Claw, that would love to help you hold on to your cards when you're playing on the go in a car or an airplane, or when you're outside, maybe a little bit of wind. Hey, Tindit, thanks for checking in for the second month. If you head on over to PlayDKP.com, you can save 5% on your order with code Jeff5. And of course, I'd like to welcome everyone out there to Hoaglandia. I know there's a lot of great people making a lot of great stuff on Twitch right now, and I appreciate you spending part of your day here with us. Remember, if you are new and enjoying my content, make sure to hit that follow button. Following the stream doesn't cost you anything, and it lets you know when I go live and with what. My green-red madness deck has a lot of sentimental value, Punchworthy, and it gets shuffled a lot. DKP dual disc wed, right? Actually, to plug the DKP further for a second, some people had asked if they would be able to buy extra inserts, and the creator said that they do have extra inserts for purchase on their website now. It was just a backorder issue. So, if you were someone that was thinking about getting one but was hesitant because you couldn't just buy extra of the magnetic inserts, you can now do that. This hand is not particularly good against an aggressive start. It's very probable that I should have mulliganed this hand just because it didn't do anything till turn three. So, that's a good question. So, what's the downside of playing more dual lands? The big downside is if you look at my deck has 8 one-mana green cards in it, and there are only 8 green shock lands in the format. So if I play more green duels instead of my basic forest, I am far less likely to have a turn one untapped green source. So the reasoning for not having more green dual lands in this deck instead of the basic forest is because of the probability to play one of my 2/1 drops on one. Like I said, we might just get embarrassed with this hand. The opponent is stumbling a little bit here, so maybe this Rekindling Phoenix is going to stabilize the board for us a touch, but definitely think I should have mulliganed this. Like, if we hit, like, a Scragon Hellkite next turn, we could be okay. Yeah, mana bases are very complicated, and they're one of the things that adds so much depth to the deck building in Magic. And, like, the thing here is, if they don't want to throw away a Knight of Grace on this attack, they're going to have to, like, pay 4 to attack into my Phoenix that just comes back. But they're ugly, so where are your priorities? Asking the real questions. We could get, like, Conclave Tribunals here. If they have Baffling End, Chump blocking, the Danto Vanguard becomes less good. But I don't think I can continue sitting here getting my health total pounded.
Evil from this plane.
Yeah, they might have a removal spell for the egg peak, but like, how am I winning this game if I'm not just like being defensive, right? Like, I don't have the luxury of playing around things because I'm too far behind at this point, is basically what it comes down to. So this attack seems really bad on my opponent's part because they're basically paying 1 life here to do nothing unless they have a way to deal with this egg. Which they, I just say, I don't think there's any way they can have to deal with the egg. Ravager Worm is a pretty sweet hit here. All right, so I think I'm going to shock this in and play this for 3 because playing this for 3 means it can block the Knights of Grace profitably. I think Rekindling Phoenix needs to be on kill Gideon duty here. Well, remember, Ravager Worm does not kill any non-basic land. It only kills non-basic lands that have a non-mana ability. So I cannot Ravager Worm to kill this Guildgate. That is not a legal play. So if they attack with everything this turn, I'm probably going eat this, chump here, take 5 down to 6. I'll have to shock this in and go to 4. Krasis will kill this, and then I'll have 2 creatures on defense, which leaves me in an okay spot, depending on what they have. If they have a removal spell for this Krasis, I'm probably going to be up a creek without a paddle.
I believe in you, friend.
Captain Command, coming in hot with the very generous tier 3 resub. I appreciate the support. Welcome, welcome, welcome back. Thanks for keeping me around. Yeah, so like, I think, like I said, my hand ultimately shouldn't have been a keep to start. So, like, I'm going to 3 here, which then means I'm just dead. Or I'm going to 4, which means I'm just dead if I do this next turn. Yep. Because my opponent stumbled, that game was closed, but ultimately that was a great example of a game where I shouldn't have kept a hand that was lands and spells because it just didn't do anything fast enough. I'm going to cut these Hydroid Krasis against an aggro deck. I'm going to cut Sunder Shaman. Reclamation's Age is actually probably pretty good here because they almost certainly have what's it called? Well, welcome, Psyduck. I think I'm going to cut the Kioras. Probably don't need to generate that much card advantage here. Hey, McCary, thank you for the 2-month resub. I appreciate that. Welcome, welcome, welcome back. Thanks for keeping me around. Cyanide, coming in hot with the 10-month resub. Welcome, welcome. I appreciate you keeping me employed here. One of the things that's interesting, and this is something that potentially impacts me as a player who's like grinding the ladder, because they're adding MPLs, because they're adding Arena Mythic Championship slots to just like to a variety of people who are outside of the MPL, the expected value of qualifying for the Mythic Championship on the ladder goes down, because the way the Arena Mythic Championships work, the top 4 people at each Mythic Championship who aren't in the MPL get invited back. So by having more people in the events who aren't MPL players, the expected value of being a non-MPL player goes down. I think I'm just going to Lava Coil this and play a tap plant here. Hopefully we hit a land to get Prime Speaker down next turn. Opponent's an aggressive deck, but almost certainly doesn't have haste cards in their black-white deck, so I'll just get in my tap for one here. Yeah, I agree that there are situations where the Avatar is going to be better than Worm, but I think the average case scenario is that Worm is better, so I'd rather just have the Worm.
Prepare for battle.
This is where the magic happens, chat. This is where the magic happens.
That was nothing. Share in my light.
No real reason to block here. Any chance you'll be at Origins or Gen Con this summer? I'd love a chance to say hi. Yeah, I'll definitely be at Gen Con. I will not be at Origins because that's the same weekend as the Nerd Rage tournament in June. I'm going to be playing Standard at that. But I will definitely be at Gen Con. If we had a 4th land here, we're probably in an okay spot. But if we don't, we're likely dead. All right, so now the question becomes, do I want a Vanifier or do I want a Phoenix? I think I want a Vanifier, and then next turn we can go, like, Phoenix, pod into Dragon Smack this. I am going to the NRG event this weekend. We'll be playing Green-Black Elves. Scale of 1 to dead, where's this Vanifier at? Now, you could maybe make the argument that I should have played the Rekindling Phoenix there, because they're likely to, like, mortify. They're likely to mortify here. Yeah, maybe in the face of a removal spell, Rekindling Phoenix is the better play.
I believe in you.
I don't know. It's like six in one hand, half dozen in the other, because like there's a chance my opponent just like has Conclave Tribunal as their removal spell. But maybe the fact that they have a Black Splash in their deck means they're just like less likely to have that. Alright, I think I'm actually shocking this in, so I can just like play an 0-3. And like if they want to trade their Gideon for my Phoenix here, that's like acceptable for me. Yeah, so they can trade Gideon for the Phoenix by minus sixing him here. Is basically what it comes down to. I think I'm just gonna chump, take three. I guess I could block here and then force them to pay four life, but I think I'd rather have one more hit point than have them be at four less. Wow, that's really good. That makes my no block with this a lot worse, because I wanted the guarantee to have this so I could pressure this next turn. Hopefully I hit a land so I can worm them.
I will lend you my strength.
Was that a good draw, chat? How do we feel about that one? Scale of like 1 to great. Where does that one fall? Lava Coil is one of the best removal spells in this format. If you don't have four of them, you're probably making a mistake.
Bring it on.
Oh, it's just like, I think there's enough Rekindling Phoenix decks in the format that you definitely want a bunch of that card. That also, like, notably takes their black permanent off the table, which makes their Knight of Grace worse, which is nice. Woof. Yeah, feels like we're dead here. I need to hit a, I don't even know what I can hit. Like, another Lava Coil still feels like it leaves me pretty dead, right? Because I can't trade with these profitably. I guess I get to recast Squee. So, like, yeah, the out is another Lava Coil.
Leave the darkness.
So if I hit Lava Coil, I can Lava Coil this, have this kill this, and then replay Squeeze so I'm not dead on board. Oh, I am still. No, because this won't have three power anymore. Close game. I don't know. I don't think there was anything I could really do in the second game that was meaningful, but the first game I definitely shouldn't have kept my opening hand, so that one's on me. Hey, Punisher, thanks for the 4-month resub. I appreciate that. Welcome back. Thanks for keeping me employed here. How is Modern today? Good. We lost on a mold of five, and then we won all the rest of the matches with Elves. Tofu Cow! Thanks for re-upping your Prime support this way. There's a lot of great people right now on Twitch. Thanks for keeping me around with that. Enjoyed the Raoul Meme King combo, starting to build towards Black Waiter Aristocrats. That deck looks sweet. Thought I'd resub to say thank you. Well, thanks for keeping me around, Yasiridi. This hand looks great, right? Needs to draw a couple of lands, but turn one elf is definitely tough to pass up.
so good.
The good news is we have a Hellkite next turn. How long have we been on this deck? About half an hour. Alright, so the Sorin implies that they're actually a mid-range deck, right? That's what that implies. Do I just hit this? Or do I want to put this to two? I think I'm going to kill the Teferi. And then next turn, even if they kill this, I can roll Silisk onto here and then smack Sorin for three. That's really unfortunate. Alright, so this play makes me want to put Rekindling Phoenix down, I think. See if they have some of these hero decks have main deck D-Spark, which is scary, but Phoenix is definitely our most resilient threat, so we want to deploy that here.
Right on schedule. Yep. Let's take it back.
One dragon, please. One dragon, please.
What a mess.
I guess this lets me kill their Teferi. I like get to throw away my Land War Elves to kill Teferi. This is like not the Stone Cold Bratwurst.
We will meet again. Trust me. You'll thank me later. Don't worry. I got this.
Like to hit a land here so we can get Hydroid Crisis down. Draw a couple of cards, get a little evasive pressure going. Alright. So that's not the worst draw in the world. Yeah, opponent start was pretty good, for sure. Wasn't super aggressive, but it's had a lot of good interactive elements. The fact that they have this and God Eternal is the main makes me think they're playing a little bit more controlling version of Esper Hero. Scale of one to dead. Where's Prime Speaker at?
No, I am not making this up as I go. I abhor my need for blood.
As you will. Snap trading Phoenix for this 4/4 if they offer it. My health total is just too low. They have a removal spell.
I've got it. Only time will tell.
Sorry, little Grazer, you gotta take one for the squad.
Time for a drink.
Sorin is up to 18. I don't know if I can kill this card before it kills me, huh? What a silly game.
What a mess I've made. You're working up my appetite. The weak feed the strong.
I think this is actually a better attack, right? Because, like, if they block with either of these, I'm, like, okay with that result. I don't think they want to block. I'm playing all my lands out because there's more Krisis in my deck. Alright, so we're dead. Not a whole lot to do there. Definitely a matchup where Phoenix and Lava Coil come in. Vivian and Tamio sound good. Exclusion Mage actually seems good here. Sunder Shaman seems less than ideal. What do I want to cut here? It's probably some of my mana creatures, but Arboreal Grazer blocks Thief of Sanity, so I probably don't want to cut that one. I think it's probably Paradise Druid. Do I trim a Hellkite? I need five more cuts here. Maybe it's just all the mana creatures. They're like pretty bad when we get grinding. I think I'm going to just leave a Boreal Grazer in as an accelerant. Let's try this. Yeah, like we can pod the one drops, but like that's about all they do. Which is one of the neat things about the sloth, right? Like it has meaningful text outside of just like ramping us because of Stonewall's Thief of Sanity. This hand's not super fast, but this also isn't a matchup where we need to be super fast. So this hand's very resilient, has a lot of redundant cards in it. So it's definitely what I want against a deck full of Thought Erasures. Because of the reason I literally keep saying Captain Command, because of Thief of Sanity. Alright, hoping to run off a couple of lands here in a row. They notably can't take our 3-drop here because we get to cast it from the graveyard. Which is sweet. That's a good draw in the event that they have a Thief or a Hero here that they wanted to protect. If they don't play a Thief, I really want to draw a land. I want to draw a land regardless, but land would be the ideals. Have you played a Sultai Super Friends deck? I don't believe so. As always, you can find everything that I do on my website and my YouTube channel. Sweet. Good little Fibble Thip. Stumble your way into that land drop for us. I genuinely think the Sloth might be better than Land Whirls in this format. Willem, thanks for the 17-month resub. I appreciate that. Welcome back. I have Dovin's Veto in against me. Tyrant Scorn, deal. Run away! Well, that went about how we expected. Unfortunately, we drew a land here, and it was another Nana. Another non-whatever. I think we're probably dead here. Feeling rather dead. I'm gonna jump block because it's free-ish. If we hit another blue source, we'll like Fibble Thip plus Banifier next turn. Do I just jam this? Yep, I don't think we're ever getting past that. Yikes. Swing low, sweet chariot. Come along to carry me home. Do-do-do-do-do-do-do. Great. All things considered, 1, 2, 3 sounds pretty good. Hands a little bit light on red mana, obviously. But if we hit the first red source, Kiora basically makes it 2. Thanks, Mikey. And triple C99, thank you for the brand new Prime support. There's a lot of great people making a lot of great stuff on Twitch right now. Thanks for supporting me on this month with that. Hope you're having a fantastic start to your week. Right. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Thanks for keeping me around this month with that. I could Hellkite here, but I think I'd rather just Kiora. A lot of these green-red decks don't have Lava Coil on the main right now, so there's a good chance this card just, like, stays active, and we get to, like, go Fibble Thip into a 3-drop next turn on the back of Kiora. Get to get a lot going. Ooh, that's a Rekindling Phoenix. Huh. So, yeah, I think I'm going to go ahead and Rekindling Phoenix here. Draw a card. And then I'm going to go ahead and pod Rekindling Phoenix into Rolsalisk. And I want to pump something up here. Probably just Vanifier to make her harder to kill. Yeah, definitely Blitz Legend. That deck was really sweet. 10 out of 10, would love to play it again. That's a pig. Alright, so my triggers are auto-stacking right now, which maybe I should turn back off. We were playing the green-black deck earlier, and it was nice for that. What do I have that I can get here? Pod Elf into Fibble Thip and then Reflector Mage or Exclusion Mage. That seems like a decent idea. I like that line. Worm doesn't accomplish a lot here, right? Because he's not big enough to kill the 6/6.
The ocean surges, life thrives.
We drew a red source here because we're great. They're pretty buried there. Lava Coil, just one of your best cards in these Rekindling Phoenix Spear matches. Not close. I don't know that either of these are good enough. I think because my opponent's on Boar God, that probably means they're not on Scragon Hellkites, or at least not a lot of them. So Vivian's stock goes down a little bit in a matchup like this. Definitely want all my acceleration. Sunder Shaman's body is okay, but I think it's probably lackluster other than that. I think Disdainful Stroke's a little narrow. I think I'd rather just have cards that play to the board. I got one more trim here. I'm going to trim the Jade Light Ranger. Like I said, I think I want to keep all my acceleration at the bottom. Like, if you think about what our deck is doing, a lot of the time we're tapping out consistently in the early turn, so we're not going to have the opportunity to hold up a card like Disdainful Stroke. And I think that makes boarding it in a lot less appealing. Yeah, Kiora untapping Banifier is a heck of a lot of utility. This hand needs a third land, but if it finds it, it's very good, right? I get to, like, turn two this, turn three this, potentially. Get two shots at it. Perfect. Hey, Blitz Legend, thanks for the support. But Legacy Blue Black Tricks plus Narset will do.
Come and destroy.
Yeah, I agree. Apex Predator's been very reasonable. I'm gonna bin that. I think I just want to give myself the best chance to like stick this next turn as a possibility. When you pod Rolsalisk into the worm, can you stack the triggers so you proliferate the red characters in the worm? You cannot. So the reason why is when you sack the Rolsalisk, the pod trigger goes on the stack, and then the proliferate always goes on top of it, regardless of how you have your stacking set up. I think I just do this. If they have a pig god plus a scary thing to put into play, we're going to be in a lot of trouble here. Because the old rhythm gives it haste.
We won't answer our accuse.
That's a big one. Yikes. They did miss a land drop, but they have lots of mana creatures, right? So, like, even if I would have killed... If I would have killed this, they wouldn't have been able to play the worm, but they still would have been able to play a 5-drop, so I don't think that's really worthwhile.
Bustin' heads is my bread and butter.
All right, they just put a 1/1 counter on that, so that bodes really well for us. It means they don't have anything good to floop into play this turn. If they had something good to put into play, they would have smacked us with both of these and, like, put their thing down, right? What's our out here? Well, I mean, if they don't have a thing, AGH, why am I... I'm not even behind at the moment. Like, I have these phoenixes that keep coming back that come up the board. Like, I feel like our opponent's currently a little bit ahead, but they're not ahead by a significant margin. Yeah, Rekindling Phoenix is a very, very good blocker. If we're going to a casual standard tournament tonight, what would you play? I really like the Bantbo deck. It's definitely my pick for favorite thing right now. And they have, like, a Goblin Chain Whirler here, I'm dead, but, like, we're never beating that, so... Not gonna play around it. Yeah, probably Bright Star. They probably didn't think that fully through. Alright, so, like, the pig comes back, but again, it's just, like, not doing anything scary right now. This goes back to their hand. Do I take this opportunity to kill Domri? Do I die on the backswing? I suppose, do I just try and kill them? No, because if I try and kill them, they play this with haste. Yeah, that's probably it. I probably just knocked Domri to one so he can't fight. No, I think I'm dead now, right? Because I have to chump block. So, like, this has haste. So it's, like, seven. Yeah, I'm pretty close to dead here. So I get to go, like... Oh, they didn't give this haste. That's really good for me. Now I get to deploy some blockers here. Do I send two at them? Sending two at them leaves them the ability to have a removal spell on Domri, which seems not ideal. I think I'm just going to do this. Yeah, I agree. The fact that these beefers don't have trample is a big deal. And taking Domri off the table reduces their power across the board too, right? Which is appealing from my defensive standpoint. Because the Domri would have removed a blocker... Right? I think the Domri would have removed a blocker. Or the Domri would have... I would have had to chump block with the Phoenix, and then the Domri would have down ticked to kill an egg so I don't have them lethal on the backswing. Well, the Domri wouldn't be at one if I attacked them. So I when I said I'm dead on the backswing, I meant if I attacked them aggressively. So that's why maybe you're confused as to what point I was referring to. When I was referring to dead on the backswing, I was running through the permutations of what could happen depending on where I set my Rekindling Phoenixes. Yeah, Rekindling Phoenix is like really, really good. See, it needs a blue source, but I think it's a keep. See, it's not terrible against a controlled X. We're gonna have time to fumble around a little bit. It is until they have, like, Thief of Sanity next turn. Not surprised to see Phoenix go away. Just one of our best cards against these archetypes, regardless of which one they're playing. Yikes. That is a phenomenal draw. Adds pressure to the table while simultaneously digging us to some lands here, hopefully. Come on, Jade Light, I believed in you. Hey, DJK, good morning. Afternoon, depends on where you are, I suppose. Looking like some kind of blue-black mid-range. Yep. Probably buried at this point. You're not wrong, guy. Definitely could have been more specific about blue. Blue is the least represented color in our deck. I think there's only 12 sources, but there also just aren't a lot of blue spells in our deck. We just happen to have drawn almost all of them. Blue source, please. Blue source, please. This is where the magic happens. I think this card just basically always stays in your deck tinted. This is basically a 5-drop that you don't feel bad to pod through. So when you put it into play, it does something. And when it leaves play, it also does something. So like, if your goal is to get to a Ravager Worm, getting this on 5 to then turn it into a 6 the next turn feels good. What exactly do I want to cut? Exclusion Mage is good because they probably have Venture the God Eternals. I think I want to keep most of my top end here. It's probably cut a Mana Dork. The question is, do I want to cut Paradise Druid or Landwar Elves? I think I want to keep this because it has more power and it's mana fixing. D-Lux, thanks for the 2-month resub. I appreciate that. Welcome back. I'm also choosing to keep the Sloth rather than the Landwar Elves because the Sloth blocks Thief of Sanity, which they're likely to board in against us. And I really don't want to board in Lava Coil. This hand is not amazing, but it's fine. My TLDR on the MPL changes that have happened are that it feels like they've changed the direction with how they're choosing people for the MPL, but that's still in line with the fact that we just have no flipping idea on how they choose MPL players to begin with. So hopefully they decide that releasing a little bit of clarity and transparency with the process of the league is something worthwhile for the community. At least felt like we previously had some idea because, like, they started by picking, like, 32 of the best players in the world based on pro points from a previous season. And then, like, when they replaced the first player that had to step down, they replaced them with someone who had just won the previous Mythic Championship, which made a lot of sense because, like, it was, you know, so it feels like we're having a change of how they were previously picking people, which we can only guess at again because there's no transparency. We're always a liability. Never not a liability. I've been watching, learning, and improving so much. I was wondering if you could make suggestions to help yourself as someone as helpful as yourself for Limited. I'm told Ben Stark is one of the best Limited streamers to watch. Numot, I believe, and Caleb Durward would be other recommendations. MTG Nerd Girl is another person on my team that does a lot of Limited, but I don't personally watch a lot of Limited, so I'm not really sure from personal experience who's good, bad, or otherwise. I think I want to lead on Rekindling Phoenix here. Yeah, we just have no idea, Nifty. And, like, that uncertainty, like, feels bad, basically. And them tapping out here to Vraska's Contempt by Phoenix feels really good, because now it gives me a window to resolve Vivian Reed, which is sweet.
Emmett, my newest friend.
I already have a worm, so I guess we'll take a jellyfish. Don't really care about disinformation campaign at this point. I think I'm just gonna do this. Because it, like, protects me from more stuff like this. I don't have anything good in my bin at the moment, though, which feels a little bit bad. I don't have any 4-ofs left in my deck either, right? So I think I just want a plus for Rekindling Phoenix. It's the best possible card I could draw.
Seek and find.
Which means, of course, when I plus this Vivian, she's gonna find a Rekindling Phoenix.
Balance comes.
Wow. Okay. I definitely want a 6 land, so. Well, the good news is we're now 8 cards closer to finding a bird. This card's really sweet. It's a shame it's been, like, pigeonholed into reclamation decks to make everybody hate it, but this is, like, a really cool, just, like, fair grindy card. Beacon, huh? Oh, gosh. That's really not good here, huh? Glowing red circle of no. How does glowing... The immediate pulsating and then the mouse over Tameo, just like the, oh no, what have I done moment. Love me a glowing red no. You get nothing!
No one knows.
Do not cross... Wow, still no Phoenix. Well... This is incredibly likely to find a Phoenix, right? There's three of them, and they're not in the bottom seven cards of my deck. Or bottom six cards of my deck. Good golly. Alright, so what am I doing here? I think I just want a Hellkite. And I think I'm going to give Davriel a love tap here if this resolves, just because they could kill this and then make things sad for me down the line. So, like, they're at 19 here still, so I think it's worth killing this. I'm waiting a turn on the Hydroid Crisis, because once I get to 8 mana, Hydroid Crisis draws an additional card. Yeah, did we sideboard out the Phoenix, right? Alright, so there's 3 Phoenixes and 29 cards here, basically. I have seen the Narset decks in Modern. I've not played with them yet or played against them, but I've seen Conley Wood streaming something similar. There is a copy of it in the deck queue, so we're going to get to it at some point once we work our way through the rest of the backlog. Although, because I'm playing a Modern tournament this weekend, I am fitting in at least one more Elves League this week. Alright, so control deck. Do you think you can beat Vivian Emblem? You don't. That's smart. I like someone who gets it. I appreciate playing against someone who understands. Are we done here? The worm can't stone rain them there. So Interplanar Beacon. Wait, can you kill Interplanar Beacon? What's the text on Ravager Worm? Activated. No, you cannot destroy beacons. Doesn't have an activated ability. That's not a mana ability. I think this deck's fine. In fact, like I've said, for this month where I'm trying to finish in the top 1,000 on the ladder, you can kind of tell what I think about the power level of a deck by if I'm playing it on the ladder or off the ladder. Yeah, I am going to be in Iowa this weekend for the tournament. What is Beacon? Interplanar Beacon. This hand is great. Good guy Sloth coming through here. He's adorable. He's a little handsy, but he's adorable. All right, so we're hoping they don't Thought Erasure or Jade Light here, and they might not just because these two cards are so powerful. If they do take this, I expect it to be because they have more discard spells. Sweet. All right, so Jade Light hopefully draws us a card or two. Fantastic. I think I gotta bin that. Definitely just need lands. Prime Speaker Manaphere sounds wonderful. For people wondering why I didn't do this, this, and this, the Arboreal Grazer requires the land come into play tapped. It's been all right. We've had a couple of bad beats, but I think we're batting about 500 at the moment. Somewhere in the vicinity of that. Grazer gets to turn into Fibblethip next turn if we untap with Vanifier. If we don't untap with Vanifier, we're going to be in a little bit of trouble. Hoping to draw, like, Tameo next turn is our best 4-mana spell. One of the unfortunate parts about our current position is that we don't have a 5th mana source, and a lot of our big payoffs that we're excited to draw in the late game cost 5 and 6 mana. Send in the Sloth to send a message. That's fair. Prime Speaker Vanifier did not get Contempted. Well, that feels good. I would like to draw two. I think Kiora is just fine. I don't know that I would write it off as anything super amazing, but I think it's more than reasonable. Huh. So I think I actually want to hold the Hinterland Harbor in my hand here, because my opponent has showed us that they're a disinformation campaign deck, so I'd rather have a card, since I hit my 5th land here, I'd rather have a card to discard that's not this creature, and I want to hold on to this creature because my opponent's a blue-black deck, which likely means they have entered the God Eternals, so if they enter my Prime Speaker here, I want an Exclusion Mage to bounce their 4-4 token. So holding these plays around both of those things a little bit, to the best of our ability at least. Gosh, we're good at Magic the Gathering. Gosh, we're good at Magic the Gathering. If you are someone who's going to take the time to fill in the WotC survey, remember to mention your favorite Magic the Gathering streamer as well as myself in the survey at some point, even if it's just in a comment section at the end. Yay, gems. I don't have a link to the survey. I should probably find one and put it in chat, but it must have gone out today. Anywho, I think I was really happy with this. This felt really trim. One of the questions that I have about this deck that I'm not 100% certain on, and I don't know that we played enough games to figure it out. I think there's a very real possibility that Hydrate Crisis is not what this deck wants to be doing anymore. Just because there's a lot of these card advantage decks where you want to be drawing more cards, where they're just playing Narset, right? Which makes Crisis a lot worse. Tameo was, like, really impressive out of the sideboard. Part of me wants to just... And, you know, I think I'm going to do this. I think I want to cut these and just slide these Tameos along with the fourth bird into the main deck. I don't think that seems unreasonable. One place I would probably expect this deck to struggle a little bit is with the aggressive matchups like red aggro. So maybe I want a couple of cards in the sideboard that could potentially help with that. Thrashing Brontodon is kind of one of my go-to. This card is flexible while also like being good against the red deck. I mean, WotC's a giant corporation coming pizza, so, like, giant corporations don't really have feelings about people. But I'm certain there's thin-skinned people there at some point that don't like me. That's just is what it is. That's how life goes. What about Vivian? I think I'd rather have Tameo in the main. Like, being able to rebuy your other stuff and add redundancy seems really powerful. I think I like this idea. A Boreal Grazer was just A+ excellent. The more I play with this card, the more impressed I become by it. I genuinely think this card might be better than Land Whirls in a lot of spots in this format. Just between, like, not dying to Chain Whirler and being able to block Thief of Sanity. So, if you're looking for a Teamer Vanifier deck, I'm going to update the list on my website to this later today. I'm going to update it on Stream Decker right now if you want to play with it before I do that.